إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهد الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل الله فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. إنه أصدق الكلام كلام الله، وخير الحدي حدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة في البدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن الكريم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. وقال الله سبحانه وتعالى أيضا: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في حديثه: لن ينجي أحد منكم بعمله. فقالوا: ولا أنت يا رسول الله؟ قال: ولا أنا إلا أن يتغمدني الله برحمته، سددوا وقاربوا واخذوا وروحوا وشيء من دلجة وقصد القصد تبلغوا، أو كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن اهتدى بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we begin by foremost and firstly in the front of our mind by begin by thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We begin by thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, acknowledging the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us, acknowledging the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us, the number of which, if we were to count it, we would never be able to. If we were to write it, there would not be enough ink in the world for us to write them. We understand this and we know this, therefore we say, Inna alhamdulillah. All praise and gratitude are for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We also praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because He is the one deserving of all praise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the highest of all beings, the creator of all creations. And He is the one to whom all praises, all thanks, all worship is due. And as Muslims, we say subhanallah. We send our salam and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our guide, our teacher, our master, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his family, upon his companions, and upon all those who follow them in righteousness until the end of time. My dear brothers and sisters, my reminder for us here today is based on a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that I mentioned earlier, but I will just focus on one part of the hadith in which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, saddidu wa qarabu, be firm and steadfast. And in the end of the hadith, he mentioned, wa qasdal qasdal tablughu, and moderation, moderation, you will achieve your goal. And this hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was mentioning to the sahabas, not none of you will achieve Jannah through the merits of your action alone, except by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he explained how to achieve our Jannah. Now the reason why I'm mentioning this point of being firm and steadfast and showing moderation in our practice of deen is that for each and every one of us here today, If we remember what is today's date, September 11th, one of the most important and known dates across the entire world for the past 19 years. 19 years ago, for those of you who are alive, the older brothers, we knew what happened. The incident that caused the lives of over 2,000 people. And the reality is that it affected the lives of people around the entire world, not only here in North America, not only here in the United States of America. It not only affected the lives of the people who passed away due to that incident, it affected the lives of millions, billions of Muslims, over 1.5 billion Muslims around the world. We've seen both the positives and the negatives of it. And today we should remember those innocent people who lost their lives due to the drastic actions of people who do not understand really what they were doing. We should also remember the lives of those people whose lives were lost as a result of the retaliation of what happened. Muslims and non-Muslims alike suffered because of that. But what I would like for us to focus here today, first and foremost, I would like to highlight a few points. The first point I would like to highlight is the impact of this incident on the Muslim world. Now, we are all aware of the negative impacts, the wars that came as an outcome of that, the millions of lives that were lost, and those are some of the negative impacts. But there's also the negative impact of where many Muslims, thousands, maybe millions of Muslims, gave up their practice of Islam. Our sisters, many of them took off their hijab. Our brothers, many of them, shaved their beards. Our Muslims in general, many of them even changed their names, therefore giving up their identity as a Muslim. That is a negative impact. Muslims became apologetic for being a Muslim. When someone identifies themselves as a Muslim, first and foremost, they'll be afraid to say, "I'm a Muslim." But Muslims, on the whole, start becoming apologetic, having to explain themselves, or we feel the need to explain ourselves, when in many cases, there was not a need for us to do that. However, there were positive impacts. And this is something that we should feel happy about, feel good about. The good things that came out of this. First and foremost, Muslims start making a greater effort to give people proper knowledge of Islam. Prior to this, Islam was there. Many people, especially in the Western world, we went about our lives. But just as we become apologetic for Islam, many more saw the need for people to truly understand Islam, even Muslims themselves. Today, alhamdulillah, we saw the rise of many institutes and centers of Islamic learning, both physically and virtually. That today, even though when faced with COVID-19, we already have establishments, Muslim establishments here in the United States of America, many of which were initiated due to the effects of 9/11. Alhamdulillah, today, as a result of that, Islam is known across the world. In the most desolate places of the world, as long as someone has access to media, Islam is known. So when someone sees a Muslim now, it's no longer a very strange thing because they're accustomed to see this. And this opened the door for da'wah. This opened the door for da'wah, and we've seen thousands upon thousands of people accepting Islam. As a result, we learned that Islam is the fastest growing religion in the United States of America. The fastest growing religion. As Muslims, why I'm pointing out the negatives and positives is that sometimes we get so caught up with just the negative things that are happening, and we do not see the good that comes out of everything. And the reality is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the most wise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the most knowledgeable. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's the best of planners. And to the reality of the human being, to the reality of the minds of Muslims and people alike, sometimes we cannot comprehend why something happened. What is the great plan of all of this? What is the positive of this? I could remember one time I was asked, what does Islam have to say about so many children dying in many places like Palestine and Afghanistan and Iraq and Burma and all of those places? Such terrible atrocities. What does Islam say about that? And yes, it is indeed terrible and very evil to kill people, especially children. But then let's look at the good side. The good is that those kids, their place in Jannah is already set. Their parents will benefit from them, making intercession for them on Yawm al-Qiyamah. The point of that is our life in this world, as a Muslim, we know it is temporary. And this is what differentiates us from most other people. Our objective is not this world. Our objective is the Akhirah. Our objective is the Akhirah. So no matter what difficulties that we are facing here on the face of the earth, let us continue to do good. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ar-Rahman, هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. Is there reward for good other than good? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is the part where the hadith comes into play. Being firm and steadfast. Being firm and steadfast in what you do. Islam doesn't ask you to be extreme. Islam never asks you to go and kill innocent people. Islam never asks you to cause fitna in the land. Islam never asks you to create division among people. All that Islam asks us is to obey Allah and spread the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Give da'wah. As a matter of fact, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in a very famous hadith, بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Teach from me. Tell people from me, even if it is one ayah. And this is something, my dear brothers and sisters, as I was listening to the khutbah last week, when Sheikh Rafiq, he was mentioning about activism and being pioneers. What should we be active in? What should we be pioneers of? As Muslims, we have a few important duties to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First and foremost is to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be worshipping to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And very second is to spread the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, spread the deen of Islam in the land. And how do we do that? Do we do that by antagonizing people? Do we do that by killing people? Do we do that by spreading mischief in the land and negatively affecting the lives of people? No. We do that by showing people what Islam is first and foremost. Being a Muslim as dictated by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not by somebody else. That is why even as we teach you Islam, even as those people who are learned teach you Islam, they have no right to give you anything other than that which is from Allah and His Rasul. And every scholar, whatever they teach you, will always have a basis in the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is why if we were to emulate the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our lives, in every aspect, from the way we speak, to the way we walk, to the way we dress, to how we deal with our neighbors and our family and our friends and our spouses and our children, truly emulate the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our actions alone will be sufficient da'wah for most people. Our actions alone. And we saw this throughout history. This is not the first time Islam is in the limelight. It's not the first time. And it will always be there. Because Islam stands as the vanguard against evil spreading across the world. And as believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have to be firm upon Islam, first and foremost, in our life. In our obedience to Allah, amr bil ma'ruf wa nahy anil munkar. Enjoin that which is good, and turn away and prevent that which is evil. That is our first duty. Let us not be apologetic to be a Muslim. Let us be proud to be Muslims. That is why we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the beginning of the khutbah. Because to be here, to be a Muslim, is truly a ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَنْ يَهْدِ اللَّهُ فَهُوَ الْمُهْتَدِ Whomsoever Allah guides, and he is guided. And in another part is mentioned, whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides, none can misguide. So the guidance of Allah, it's a ni'mah from Allah. So we shouldn't be apologetic for that. We are thankful of that. We are proud to be Muslims. At the same time, we should also truly learn what Islam is. Our source for Islamic knowledge is not Facebook or YouTube or Google. No, that is how misconceptions of Islam spreads even among the Muslim community. Because you have either of two extremes that will come out of that. The extreme of where people misunderstand verses of the Quran due to people lacking knowledge of Islam giving explanations of the Quran. Or two, people seeking ways just to become complacent in the practice of Islam. We will find people trying to find a way to make riba permissible in Islam. We will find people trying to find a way to make that which is haram permissible in Islam because they want to indulge in that which is haram. But they have some iman in their hearts, so they want to find a way in which Islam will make that permissible. So they wish for evil. That is not amr bil ma'ruf wa nahy anil munkar. That is not enjoining right or forbidden evil. Forbidden evil is also hating it in our heart, not seeking it. My dear brothers and sisters, let us not kid ourselves. In the world we are living in today, being worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is becoming increasingly difficult. And not so much only because of people who are antagonizing Muslims and they're anti-Islam and anti-Muslims, but because of ourselves today, our heart is for this dunya. Muslims around the world today, after that incident, we see so many Muslims, they dove into materialistic gains. Children are taught to excel more in their academics rather than Islam, not to find that balance. Our brothers will give up our Jum'ah Salah because they have to work. No, that is not finding that balance, my dear brothers and sisters. Being moderate in Islam, it means do not take upon yourself more than you can bear. Being moderate in Islam, which means something that everyone can take part in. Being moderate in Islam doesn't mean to give up the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can't say you're a moderate Muslim when you give up your salah. No, you're not a moderate Muslim. You're a deficient Muslim. When you take off your hijab, no, you're not a moderate Muslim. You're deficient in your practice of deen. Because these are commandments. This is fard in the sight of Allah. We cannot make that which is fard to make it optional. We have to do them. But moderation means that not every one of us have to stand and pray salatu tahajjud like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until our feet become swollen. No, if we wish to, alhamdulillah, but it doesn't mean that we must compel it upon everyone else. Moderation of Islam means that we don't have to be like Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah alayhi, who would recite the Quran thirty times in the month of Ramadan. No, not everybody can do that. Not everybody can take out $1 million every day and give it in charity. But moderation means doing as much as you can do within the confines of Islam. Do not exert yourself. Because the scholars, they explain moderation, because our journey is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so they explain moderation like this. They said, if you start a race off, if you're on a fast horse and you're going to a far destination, and you start off very quickly, then you will never be able to complete that destination. You know, you will burn out before you reach there. But if you take that journey moderately, step by step, you will reach your goal. And that is the meaning of qasdul qasdul tablughu. And moderation, you'll reach your goal. So I'd like to close this khutbah here today with this reminder, my dear brothers and sisters, with these few reminders. Let us become Muslims who are active in the da'wah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the duty upon every single one of us. Only recently I was reminded, you know, they are messengers, they are Nabi and Rasul. They are messengers and they are prophets. And then they are messengers of the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives us the command, transmit from me, teach from me even one ayah, that each and every one of us can be messengers from the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because we are transmitting his message to the entire world. And how do we do that? By telling people Islam, by telling people what is Islam, by practicing Islam, not through nefarious and aggressive mannerisms. Also, my dear brothers and sisters, it is imperative that we seek knowledge and seek proper knowledge of Islam. Do not become lazy and decide to stay in your home to seek knowledge. Go out wherever it takes you to seek knowledge, make that effort. For our destination is not here. Each and every one of us, we know our destination is the Akhirah. That is the real life. This is temporary. Let us not get caught up with just building our abode here. Let us build our Akhirah. It doesn't mean that we can't enjoy the few luxuries of this world, that is encouraged, but not at the expense of the Akhirah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us in the Quran, remember that this world is one of distractions and luxuries and the like. Remember that. And we as believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no matter the challenges that we are faced with, we must be firm and steadfast in our obedience to Allah, in our actions, in our da'wah, in our pursuit of knowledge, in our pursuit of justice in the land, in our pursuit of peace. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all and guide us all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all to be from among those who are steadfast. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect this religion. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect peace and justice across the entire world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala liberate people, no matter religion, no matter their race, in every part of the world who is under oppression. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove the oppressors from our lands. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us with a guiding light that will protect us upon the path that is the path of الجنة. آمين. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وآخر دعواني الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن اهتدى بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم انصرنا، اللهم اهدنا، اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين في كل مكان، اللهم احفظ إسلام المسلمين في كل مكان. اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة ونعوذ بك من النار. اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا ورزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من عذاب القبر ومن عذاب الجهنم ومن فتنة المحيا وممات ومن شر فتنة المسيح الدجال. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من البرص والجنون والجذام ومن سيء الأسقام. عباد الله رحمكم الله، إن الله يأمركم بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله يذكركم واستعينوا يستجب لكم ولذكر الله تعالى أكبر. وأقيموا الصلاة، إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا.